All right. Where would you like me to come in?
Yes, please.
With no. Well, okay. That too. But with. You bamboozled me.
This podcast is a member of the Place to Be Nation family. Visit us at placetobenation.com, the only place to be in your pop culture world.
Hey, you! Yeah, I'm talking to you, sassy girl. Need a little in your step? Try this on for size.
It's pop.
Tastes great. It makes you feel kind of funny. Not here, not down there, but all up in this area. And coming jumbo pop.
Hi, Place to Be Nation. Welcome to Talking Pop. My name is Jennifer Smith, and I'm here with the imitation crab meat dip to my tortilla.
It's Tim Wow. Cable. Was not expecting that one. Thank you, Jenny.
I worked hard on it all day.
You really did, and it shows, and I appreciate you. Thank you. Tonight's episode of Talk and Pop for me is sponsored by Bacardi Superior. Who is your sponsor tonight, Jenny?
Mine would be Crown Royal.
Okay.
And Coke That's Zero. Choice. And Fireball.
Excellent.
And the Lore
excellent,
tab I had earlier.
That's a great panel right there. Yeah. I mean, it really is. Yeah. Especially like the addition of the Lore tab at the end.
You know, that was way earlier, so I'm sure it's not effective anymore.
Okay. Well, you know, their dollars still spend, I guess. Mm-hmm. We have tonight actually two guests. I think that's a first for Talking Pop.
Outside of our 90210 panel, yes.
Yeah. I feel like that was an outlier with a special. But speaking of Beverly Hills 90210, we have West Beverly's own Kelly and Steve.
Kelly and Steve. What an amazing introduction.
That also is of the Songs with Friends podcast. Welcome, Kelly. Welcome, Steve.
Kelly.
that was Steve.
Yeah, I'd like to thank you guys for inviting us to Jen's intervention.
Is that what we're doing? I'm not ready.
Yeah, it's surprise.
No.
Surprise, surprise, yes.
Those have to be in person. I already researched that. Not going to work.
So you know you have nothing to fear.
I ain't scared.
Amazing.
Thank you, Steve. Hello, Kelly. How are you?
I'm good. I'm excited. I was so excited when you guys asked us to come on, so thank you.
I was excited that you said yes. I feel like we go through this with every invitation we send to our guests. We're like, they might say no. We won't take it personally, but that's all right.
Nobody has said no yet.
One has said no. We should stress. So keep that in mind, listeners. You could be on our short list, and you don't want to be the first person to say no, right?
Yes. No, not at all.
Keep the streak alive like the Undertaker.
Until it isn't, right. At least. But had a good run, and we've had a good run. So we're really glad to have Kelly and Steve with us tonight. I feel like long awaited, long anticipated, perhaps. We've teased you with it, and now we aim to please you with it.
Wow.
You know, going back to the Stacey episode of Talkin' Pop, we've kind of been looking at each other from across the room. Like daring each other to make the first move. And props to you guys. You guys did it.
Yeah, we've been passing notes to friends, but kind of not to each other. I think sort of by design, playing these little Elizabethan parlor games on Twitter. I enjoy it. Mm-hmm. Big fan. But now, I mean, gosh, it's almost like where do we go from here? You know, we've done it. We've peaked. And what is there to even talk about here? You guys host the Songs with Friends podcast, also here on Place to Be Nation, Pop. And I guess I just want to start off with a softball question, an actual softball question, not like the one we threw our friend Glenn Butler a few episodes back.
Oh my goodness.
I thought you meant an actual question about softball. I'm like, we don't do sports here.
So, oh my God.
Can be better. How did the show get started, Songs with Friends? What made you guys come together and want to do this podcast?
All right, I'll jump in here because this was pretty much my brainchild.
Okay.
Going back as far as the spring of 2017, I was in a gas station with my daughter, and that terrible song, Come On Eileen, came on. And as I have every time for the last 25 years since I've heard that song, I giggled because, haha, Come On Eileen. And then later that day, I looked it up, and this song actually is about coming on Eileen.
Oh, well.
Well, I guess we found an opening song for the show.
Yeah. And I thought, shit. Like,
yeah, that's always a tricky endeavor with this show, coming up with the songs. And I thank you for supplying that right off the bat.
I'm here for the team. But I thought, all right, if this has been in plain sight all these years, how many of other songs are like this? And just something I just tucked away and didn't really think too much about. At the same time, I'd started doing podcasts on the wrestling feed for the Greatest WWE Wrestler Ever podcast or project.
Yes.
And as that wrapped up, I was kind of looking for something else to do on the feed, and I heard that Dido song that we did on episode 1, White Flag.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought, man, what could she have done that was so fucking terrible that this dude has just completely rolled her out of his life altogether? And that she's saying, all right, you can tell me I'm not coming to come around, but damn it, I'm not surrendering. I'm going to keep coming back, no matter what this restraining order says.
That's just a suggestion.
So, it inspires a lot of headcanon, these songs, so I definitely appreciate that.
So then the more I thought about it, I'm like, you know what, this may be a podcast, and in my mind, I pictured it being with a female companion. And at the time, Kelly and I were in a heated series of Words with Friends games.
Ah, okay.
Interesting.
I'm like, all right, Kelly, this girl's easy to talk to. She knows her music shit. Why not throw her a bone? If she said no, the backup was going to be Stacey O'Loughlin.
Okay.
Hey, Stacey is nobody's backup.
Oh, no.
Because Stacey's amazing, she's also easy to talk to. She knows podcast or she knows music and she's relatable. Yes. So I thought, all right, logistically it would be a stretch to do this regularly, but let's talk Stacey into doing this if Kelly says no. Thankfully, Kelly agreed, and here we are a year later.
Interesting.
Kelly,
I did not know.
What made you say yes?
Really?
I need to know.
This is going to sound crazy. I had never even heard a podcast till I started talking to Steve. I never had listened to one in my life. So I was like, oh, let me check one out. But I don't know if I've ever told him this. I didn't want to say yes. Like, I felt sick. I was like, oh, fuck no. I'm not going to be good at this. I get nervous, talking in front of a group of people and shit. So I was like, I don't really want to do it. But he was, so excited, and he thought I could do it. So I was like, I'll try it. And I didn't really think, we'd still be doing it, honestly. I thought, we'd do a couple shows, and he'd be like, I'm going to find someone else. But here we go. So.
Well, did you fall in love with it?
Yes. You know what? It's crazy, though, because in a serious side of it, it changes the way I think about music now, which some of it's good, some of it's bad, because I can't even hear a song now without, Googling the lyrics or, needing to know. So it's almost like an obsession now in a weird way, but I love it. I've always loved music anyways, but it's made it even worse. It's probably not a good thing, but it's awesome.
That's something else I was wondering too. The whole just lyrical side of it is, a song is of course a composition of a lot of things, lyrics being one of them. And so I wondered if you found yourselves in any situations where it's like, okay, the song itself makes you feel one thing, but the lyrics are kind of talking about something entirely different. And kind of how you grapple with that on the show.
Nirvana, right away. Nirvana's songs are about nothing at all.
I love Nirvana. Of course. That's one of my, I love them.
And I was forced to concoct a kind of backstory on the fly of Kurt Cobain being on a heroin binge and watching The Price is Right. and just all kinds of shenanigans ensuing. And that is how I got through that very painful 25 minutes of Songs of Friends. But that ended up being a segment that a lot of our listeners like reached out to us like, hey, man, that was awesome. Like, how the hell did you come up with this shit? And I'm like, man, I don't know. Just, you know, we hit record.
Because you have to.
Yeah, we read lyrics, and, you know, if there's something there, great. If not, well, we'll make something happen.
But it ruins, Steve has ruined songs for me. Like, seriously.
I was wondering that, too.
Like, songs that I, like, I can't remember one of the Red Hot Chili Peppers songs we did. I was like, I could, like, see getting, like, walking down the aisle to this shit. You know what I mean? And Steve's over there, like, he just thinks differently than I do. I don't know. Maybe because he's a guy, but it's Steve. And so he has ruined some songs for me a little bit, but it's okay. It's just the way he sees things. So that is a struggle sometimes because I'm like, I don't want to pick a song I really, really love because I don't want to think about it in a bad way.
Yeah, that's kind of a early 90s grunge thing, right? Where it's the lyrics aren't really about anything. It's just sort of let's pull some words together that rhyme or at least have a slant rhyme going on in such a way that it sounds sort of profound maybe, but it isn't because it seems like just not a lot of thought went into the lyrical side of this. Like, they can be great compositions, you know, musically, and what comes together in the studio and production-wise, and then it's sort of like the lyrics almost feel like an afterthought. So hey,
I mean, rhyming is hard. I mean, you just have to put together sure. some shit that rhymes. I mean, and yeah. then, you know, like, imagine that it means something to you at some point.
Yeah.
And Weird Al nailed it when he did Nirvana, and he said something like, it's hard to bargle Nardole's house with all these marbles in my mouth.
Exactly.
There you go.
That is exactly the situation we found ourselves in with that song.
But I think Steve grew up listening to different music a lot compared to what I did. So it's kind of interesting because I was all rock always forever. Mm-hmm. You know, I didn't really listen to anything different till maybe I got to like high school, a little bit in junior high. But Steve listens to a lot. So that's been nice because I've actually learned about a lot of music that I wouldn't have never listened to before. And I have enjoyed that part of it. But, you know, I don't like him ruining my songs. But, you know. He's going to keep doing it. So.
Sure. So has this sort of influenced how you, I don't know, curate the songs for the show, where you might be thinking, oh, here's one of my favorite songs I'd love to talk about. But then you look at the lyrics and you go, maybe not songs with friends material. Do you have that problem as well?
You want to answer that, Steve? It's like, no.
Not for me, because
you both answer that.
That is where I thrive.
Like, yeah.
The more bullshit we can get out of the song, the better off I am.
That's how I feel about it.
Yeah.
Like, you want to come up with some insane backstory.
Me and Mrs. Jones, I came up with this whole idea that every night she makes her husband dinner and then goes to this diner and just orders the fucking, the pecan pie because she's already had dinner. And our young lover showing up to eat the meatloaf platter because he's starving because he doesn't have a woman that cooks for him.
Yeah.
They think they're getting away with it, but the waitress is looking at him like, look at that whore. You know, what is she doing?
Hey, don't judge her.
Mm. Hey, yeah. Honestly, it was 1972. This is a waitress. You know, things were different back then.
Yeah.
This lady's been she's been at home all day. It's 1972, so she has at least 6 kids. Right. She's making dinner for, yeah. And all she wants to do is go to the diner and have coffee with this guy and hopefully get fucked afterwards.
That's what I'm saying. Quit judging her for it.
Yeah.
Well, okay. I don't know that they're judging, but the song may be looking at it through a very 1972 lens.
Yeah. The time period on some of the songs to us is fascinating because you're just, you know, just how the world was at that time. But I think I tend to pick songs more that I do love most of the time. I mean, I have a probably unhealthy habit of my daughter, it drives her nuts. Like, once I'm into a song, like, I could listen to it for days, like over and over a week. I don't even know, just like on repeat. Mm-hmm. And so I like to pick songs that I've actually had that kind of obsession with before. But Steve finds a lot of crazy songs, but yeah.
Excellent. Jenny, do you have any other questions about songs with friends?
Songs with friends. So you guys are a couple. Is that correct?
Allegedly.
Allegedly. Allegedly. All right. So did that manifest itself any way during the podcast?
I'll take this one. So we have been doing this show since May of last year, I think is when the first one dropped. We recorded a few weeks before that, if I'm not mistaken. In that time, my marriage just completely fell apart, unrelated to Kelly. And there were times when, you know, after moving out, being here by myself for weeks at a time, like I would go to work and this show would be my only adult interaction sometimes. So yeah, you know, that kind of environment tends to breed some feelings.
Yeah.
And, next thing I know, we're planning trips and hanging out, and one thing leads to another, and here we are.
Well, it's a beautiful thing that,
that
a podcast.
That was vague, unspecific. Thanks for that.
A podcast can lead.
Was it? I felt like it was specific. Just kidding. Oh,
no. All right, Judy, let's check the receipts here. On February the blank.
Thank you.
At 09:27 p.m.
Isn't there a lot to be said for what feels like the very limited amount of adult interaction that you might have during a time that is, let's say, stressful, and you're just kind of looking for an outlet and, you know, something to really pour your interest into and potentially pour your heart into, mm-hmm. as it seemed to, these things aren't planned, but it's probably not an uncommon story, I feel like, but very beautiful thing that the Songs with Friends podcast has brought to the nation. So I like it.
Yeah, it was pretty exciting. I wasn't that far off from Steve. I'm divorced much longer than he has been. But I mean, I think it is when you find something that, you know, when you go through like you're with someone for a very long time and then you're single, it is different. Life is different. You're not used to that. And so it was, you know, probably one of the reasons I said yes to him was just because I was in that, I don't know, maybe I don't know timing exactly, but how long after a divorce. And I feel like it just gave me something to look forward to. And it was exciting. And you know, it was like, oh, this is something that I can look to forward to and to do whatever every 2 weeks. And it was fun. So definitely was awesome. I needed it too. So
yeah, we would do a little, you know, like pre-recording, as most anybody who does podcasts could tell you, you know, you don't just jump on the phone and hit record. You know, there's a little bit of I don't want to say foreplay, but you know, a little little talk to loosen up before we start recording. And we went from, you know, 5 or 10 minutes before and after the show to, you know, we're recording an hour. And then I look at the Skype call and we've been talking for 3 hours. Mm-hmm. I'm like, where the hell did that time go? And I'm not a phone guy at all. So for me to be able to talk to somebody for that long and not just want to yank what little bit of my hair nubs are left out.
It's great.
I'm like, this like, this is something possibly worth pursuing. And in February, there's an opportunity for me to go to Texas, where Kelly lives. And I did so, and we met up there, and, her daughter and friends interrogated me for several days.
Good.
Sang me happy birthday no less than 17 times. And yeah, we had a good time. We connected there, and you know, kind of the rest is history.
Mm-hmm. So did the daughter and friends already kind of know you through association with the podcast?
Yes.
Well, let's talk about that.
Totally inappropriate. My daughter's 12, so it's not like she's, you know, and she's an old person. Like, she's 85 on the inside. You know?
Yeah.
80.
Yeah.
So I'm very real and forward with her, and I don't hide things, you know. She knew about Steve. It was like, I was, some guy's coming over. And so she had already known about the show, you know? And so some dude's coming by. Like, I'm not that mom, you know? It was like, there's no one comes here. I don't like to have anybody at my house, actually. Mm. So her friends, she told her friends, and there are a lot of middle schoolers that are listening to our show, which mm-hmm. is
sort of inappropriate, but in a way I feel like, well, whatever. Their parents know me. And so, you know.
Well, look, you can't choose your audience, you know?
No, yeah. Definitely not. I think yeah, that's my cool. daughter's. Yeah, my daughter's like, Mom, they were showing your logo and talking about your podcast today in class. And I'm like, oh, my gosh.
Oh,
that's
no.
That's awesome.
You're going to have to do show and tell me.
I'm going to go to jail. Like, something's going to happen. But, yeah, so, but at the same time, I mean, there are some that I'm like, oh, gosh, I hope they don't listen to this. But whatever. I mean, hey, you got to learn about life somewhere.
So. I mean, podcasts are probably the way you need to learn about these things.
Yes. By me and Steve. Yes. Yeah.
Two sound bites from the show come to mind immediately. We talked about how easy it is like to do sexting now and send pictures and whatnot, and how back in the day our parents would have to like take pictures and take them to Walgreens. Like figure out a photo
and it's, what's this?
Yeah.
And I apparently said on the air, like, is this a one stamp or a two stamp cock? There's that.
Well,
and,
is it?
Yeah. Isolate.
Are you asking me? No, I'm just kidding. Go ahead, Steve.
Yes, I am.
Kayfabe.
What's that?
Working ourselves into a shoot, I see.
Yeah, just things like that. That happens, and I'm like, oh, man, kids are listening to this show, and it's no. I'm sorry to the parents of America.
Well, and you know what's funny? I really only think, like, my one daughter's friend is actually the one that's committed to listening to, like, all of them. And, you know, she's okay. It'll be okay. She knows more than she should already.
Right. So, I promise you those 12-year-olds, they already know all this fucking shit that y'all talk about. Oh, like, I promise.
No, and truthfully, like, with my daughter, I don't know. Everyone's different about their children. If she asks me something, I'm not going to lie to her. And I tell her the truth. And I don't try to protect her from as much as maybe. I don't want to say not protect. But, I mean, I want her to understand, hey, life has real shit going on. And if she asks me about something, I'm going to tell her, you know. So that's just how it is in my house. So
I agree.
Yeah, I referenced that. And there's another song, I can't remember which one it was, where I had mentioned leaving before the girl was even dry yet.
Oh, well, yeah, they probably shouldn't have heard that.
I'm like, oh, no, this is just terrible. Like, don't let me talk to kids ever.
Well, here's the thing. I feel like, not that I'm a parent in any way, but I was a child at one point, and I just think there's...
I've never heard someone say that. That is
a
awesome.
Long time
a child
ago.
Who was a child who was born 40 as well, you know.
That's my daughter.
But there's worse things than, I guess, being raised by podcasts compared to some of the stuff we grew up with.
Yeah.
So,
like X-Men cartoons and shit?
Well, like X-Men cartoons and scrambled Skinamax porn. And Well, yeah. I guess it didn't have to be scrambled if it was on Skinamax. But, right. You know, with finding the VHS tape. I mean, we've talked about this on the show. I think dating back to our, oh, gosh, I think we got zero episodes in before we started talking about our formative years in porn.
Yeah.
So, and, I mean, that stuff is...
Well, and they can get it easier now if you think about it. I mean, my daughter has a nicer cell phone than I do, and I mean, it's like if she wants to know something, she can Google it or she'll find a way. And so I'd rather her feel comfortable to come to me and talk about it than she's like searching sex terms on the internet. You know what I mean? I would rather her, and she's asked me things that I'm like, oh, fuck, you know, but I'd rather be the one to have a conversation with her about it because she can look anything up. So. Yeah.
You're not going to direct her to Urban Dictionary, you know.
Well, I mean, you could, you know, just for fun.
But, you know, but she'll say sometimes to me, like, Mom, what did you do when you were in junior high and, you know, someone invited someone else over and their feelings were hurt? And I'm like, well, we weren't Snapchatting about it. Like, and she, you know what I'm saying? And she's like, oh, yeah, she doesn't even imagine a world without a cell phone. You know, it's like nobody knew because nobody would know unless someone told them the next week at school or whatever. You know, so their minds are just so different. You know, they're used to having that at their fingertips. So,
and for us, I mean, there was kind of a dividing line between school life and work life and home life, I should say, where at the end of the school day, like that was kind of your day and it was over. And yeah, you still had your friends who might have been your school friends or neighborhood friends or whatever, but it wasn't this just constant deluge of, like you said, Snapchat and texting and Instagram and social media, just everything out there where it's just nonstop and you don't really get a break from it. Mm-hmm. So that's one of those things that we didn't have to deal with. And the, you know, accessibility to things is a lot more robust today, let's say, but I sort of feel like in a way it makes it less of a big deal because it's so just, well, it's right there. Like, I mean, it's kind of a, you don't want, you know, your kids to be exposed to certain things, but they're not thinking of it as kind of the big deal that you are necessarily because it was such a big deal for us. So I don't know. There's maybe two sides to it.
Oh, yeah. Jenny, how old is your son?
My son will be 10 in a couple of months.
Okay.
And today he was telling me about, I think it's an app called TikTok, which I didn't know what that was. And then I felt really old when he showed it to me.
Heard of that. I don't really know what it is.
I know what that is.
It's basically like Vines for younger people, I suppose. Yeah. So like, he's like, there's this TikTok about this, that, and the other. And I'm like, what the fuck is that? But he wants to show me the most obscure shit ever online. I'm like, he showed me today he's been obsessed with the song Space Jam, which if I were ever to be invited on Songs with Friends, I might choose Space Jam as a song. But he was obsessed with that song. And then he shows me this video of this grown ass man with his plushes, his Bugs Bunny and Daffy Duck and Marvin the Martian plushes, and he's acting out the movie Space Jam.
Yeah.
That's fucking disturbing is what that is.
Yeah, like, I told him it was weird as fuck.
They, like, lip-sync these songs kind of thing, and then they make videos.
Yeah,
and,
like, he just made, like, a whole scenario and showed him in an actual basketball court, like shooting hoops, and then he had the plushes there shooting. It was just fucking weird. I'm like, go to your room with that bullshit.
Get out of my living room.
I can't.
Not interested.
Like, I just wanted to listen to the one song on Spotify, and now you have me watching this.
Yeah. Yeah.
And you're thinking, I thought I was done with this bullshit when Vine went away.
Yeah. I mean, YouTube is just like this place that I don't understand, and it's so magical and frightening.
Yeah. Oh shit, you know what? That reminds me. I need to cancel YouTube Premium. I got it to watch the Cobra Kai which is pretty good. The Karate Kid reboot continuation series. Yeah, it's not bad. Not really worth paying for though. I mean, it's literally the only thing worth watching on YouTube Premium. There is other content, but it's like, why would I even watch this for free? You know, it is a joke.
How much is it a month? Like $10 or something.
That seems I mean, it's not bad, but I do need to just cancel it before I get charged the first time. It's like a 30-day trial type thing. So, and I did the same thing last year. It was not called YouTube Premium then. It was called YouTube Red. Mm-hmm. So I guess that branding didn't catch on. But, God, it's just all this, like you said, Jenny, there is just the weirdest shit that we're not going to get as adults. I don't even know if, I don't know why anyone would be into it, regardless of what their age.
Well, I appreciate the artistic side of it, like the time it takes to put together videos and edit them together. Yeah. And like this guy had like special effects and stuff like that. So like I appreciate that part of it, but like this is what you decided to like spend your time doing. And I don't understand that. So that's fine.
Did your son like it?
Oh, he was like, thought it was great. Like,
the coolest thing, yeah.
And I'm like, I'm just trying to booty dance in my kitchen to Space Jam, but yeah, sure, let me listen to this shit.
Parenting.
Yep.
I'm kind of good not not venturing into that world. Steve, do you have kids?
Yes, I have a daughter that's about to turn 14.
Oh, boy.
Oh, Lord.
And thankfully, she's like the anti-Steve.
Okay.
Like, yeah. She's, you know, not that I wasn't smart, but she was smart and focused. Whereas I was happy just to dick around and have fun with my buddies or whatever. She's already thinking college. Ugh. And, you know, getting herself, making sure she's in the best classes and making sure she has straight A's. And like, she had an 89 on a test a few months back, and she wanted to stay over after school on Friday because she could retake it and get a higher grade.
Oh.
Wow.
I'm almost like, it's like, why the fuck? Like, what, do you rather just go get ice cream or something?
Nerd.
Yeah.
I was like that, though, so I can relate. Good for her.
So you were actually, if I recall, thinking back to back episodes of Songs with Friends, learning about your background, I learned that the Kentucky public school system was an absolute dystopia.
Yes.
Imagine still that. Is,
I don't know. Oh, that's hilarious.
It sounded dreadful. And Kelly, you had mentioned that you were just basically in love with the local drug dealer, right?
You remembered that.
Oh, yeah.
But I mean, here was the deal in my house. My dad was like, I had all brothers, and my dad was very strict about letting me do things. But if, like, my grades were good and I went to school, he was more lenient. You know what I mean? So, like, once I figured that out, I was like, I will have straight A's and I will go to school every day, you know. So then he would bend a little bit. Because I think this happens a lot with parents, but boys, you don't worry about your son as much. But when you have a daughter, then it's mm-hmm. like, you know, you kind of – and then you have brothers that are watching that too. It's, you know, but – so I don't know. I just, yeah, but I did grow up in a better school system than Steve, but I don't know how much better, but I just based on what he's told me, seemed like it was.
It was a story that kind of, in this reference, I hesitate to say this because the reference might be lost on everyone here, but it reminded me of the family and the movie from 1995, I want to say, called Welcome to the Dollhouse. Todd Solondz movie. It's one of those, like, he's done a lot of these really kind of fucked up, perverted family dramas. And that one was more tame than I think most of them that mm-hmm. he has done. But I don't know. If you had seen the movie, you'd maybe recognize some things.
That my life is like this movie?
A little. Well, not. I mean, it's a little
that
bit
part
exaggerated.
Of my life. Yeah.
Yeah. There's a. I mean, it's kind of a nice family with the older daughter is fairly studious, but kind of like hooks up with this guy who's sort of a dirtbag and just, I don't know. I don't know why your telling of that story made me think of this, but now I kind of want you to see it.
I'll watch it. I have a lot on my to watch list. Steve's always asking me, have you seen this? Have you seen that? I'm like, no. So I'm pretty, right, Steve? I'm pretty bad about movies and stuff. So
yeah, you having never seen My Cousin Vinny, despite it being on TV once every 45 minutes since 1993.
He was like, what? I've now seen it.
I was going to say, I thought you had said something about it.
Yeah, we did.
So I rented this movie via pay-per-view in the year of our Lord 2019. And I'll be goddamned if it doesn't come on TNT the next afternoon. Of
course. Just to spite you.
Mm. Well, I just think when I was growing up, my dad owned the TV. And I don't know if most people's houses were like, but it was like we had a TV in the living room and it was my dad's. So, and he pretty much always watched sports. So I didn't really grow up watching a lot of things that people did their whole life or as much TV because it was like my dad wasn't watching that shit. You know what I mean? So I don't watch TV as much as I probably could, but it's not the worst thing, I don't think.
Yeah, well, there's this one called, might have heard of it, The Shawshank Redemption.
Yeah, I've seen that one.
That's on with some regularity as well.
I've seen that several times, actually.
So. Excellent. All right. So, gosh, there's a lot of places we could go, isn't there?
So many.
So many. Steve, you have a wrestling background, which I'm sure could be like a total episode in and of itself. But briefly, can you sort of explain like the time frame here, what your involvement with the wrestling business, with the wrestling business was, and where that kind of led you?
You mean as like a fan or as an active participant?
I would say as an active participant, which probably has some overlap with being a fan.
Yeah. So in 2006, I somehow stumbled into $500 extra, which for anyone who has a very small child, my daughter was not quite 1 year old at the time. As anyone can tell you, with a child that small, $500 extra is just fucking unbelievable. You don't know what to do with it.
Yeah.
So me being a strapping 23-year-old man, I said, you know what? I'm going in the wrestling business.
There you go.
Wow. Yeah. Seems legit.
I looked up the information for Ohio Valley Wrestling's training class. And despite the fact that the WWE Developmental Center was in my backyard all throughout my early 20s, I never once thought to actually look into it. Hmm. Even though I'd been a wrestling fan since I was 8. At this point, I would have been 23. So it turns out it cost exactly $500 to start the beginner's class, which was being taught by Mikey of the Spirit Squad at the time.
Okay.
He was kind of transitioning out, and a gentleman named Mo Sexton was transitioning in as the head trainer. So this was around the time of the second ECW One Night Stand show.
Mm-hmm.
So Paul Heyman had been writing the OVW product right up until then. So me being kind of a smart marquee type fan, I'm like, all right, great. You know, I'll get to train, get to meet Paul Heyman. You know, CM Punk was just about to, actually, he was firmly in developmental at that point. I think, oh, this is going to be awesome. I'm going to meet my heroes. And yeah, none of that happened.
Wow.
Real life. What happens to all of us?
Yeah.
Well, it just seems like it's fake. You know, you've come into $500 somehow, and this costs exactly $500. Just, you know, two and two to go together here. It's meant to be.
Yeah, my ex was like, let's buy you an Xbox 360. I'm like, no, I want to wrestle. She's like, what the fuck are you talking about? So first week of class is pretty uneventful. The first day of the second week, Shad of Crime Time shows up.
Mm.
And he's just like, oh, yeah, I want to help teach today. They're like, all right, cool, whatever, get in there. And I'm trying to lock up with Shad, and I keep blinking. And because Shad has to be, I don't know what his build height is, but he's legit at least 6'4".
Mm-hmm.
Just a fucking wall of a man. And I kept blinking on the tie-up, and every time he would just chop me hard as shit in the ribs. Like leaving handprints on my torso. And I'm just like getting more and more freaked out by the situation. And I somehow managed to cut his eye with my pinky nail.
Oh,
and a collar and elbow tie-up. Which just pisses him off even more.
Yeah.
He just fucking lays into me. I think, you know what? Maybe this isn't for me. I just disappear for 2 weeks.
Okay.
You know, come back and just apologize to everybody for being a puss. Jump back into class. And really, the rest of the story is kind of, you know, more long-form podcast worthy.
Sure.
Encountering people like Ted DiBiase. Just walk into a room and Ted DiBiase is just fucking chilling, eating combos. Like, what the fuck?
Combos?
Visual.
That's so random.
Yeah, there's a couch in the back of where we trained, where there's a big projection TV. And the contract developmental people would train right before us. So sometimes you get in early and, you know, they'd still be doing their thing, so you just try to stay out of the way. And so I just wandered to the back office area, and there's fucking Ted DiBiase just hanging out, watching DVDs, eating combos. I'm like, hey, Ted. You know? Yeah, that summer, we had Cody Rhodes was in the program, so Dusty.
Oh, hey, Shmash.
Dusty came down for a match that summer. Jimmy Snuka walked right by me in a drug-induced haze, barefoot into the parking lot, never to be seen again.
Jesus.
Just all kinds of little wild occurrences like that took place that summer. I wrestled my first match on September 21st of that year. Six-man tag.
What was your wrestling name?
I was Dub Stevens.
That's terrible.
Dub Stevens?
Yeah. At the time, I worked at a hospital job, and there were multiple Steves. I became Steve Dub, so I just transposed that and made it happen. It was a shitty name, but it was going to get me through a first match.
Well, they're not going to let you use Steve Williams, probably under any circumstances.
Or Talking Death.
Yeah, all these were taken.
Right.
So, my first match, I was tanning. I was looking good. I'm like, all right, I'm going to.
You were tanning?
I was. I'm going to get rid of this chest hair, right?
Oh, yeah. You got to get rid of some body hair, right?
And when I did, my
look
body.
For that camera.
My body rejected that whole process, and I'm like. I look like I've been assaulted with a BB gun multiple times.
With a razor or waxing?
Both.
Okay. Oh. Okay.
Mm. Yeah. I was no
wax.
Yeah.
So I ended up.
He didn't do it.
I ended up wrestling with a red muscle shirt on.
Yeah.
And I did that off and on throughout this area through September of 2017. And by that time, the ghost of Chris Benoit was pretty much haunting the whole scene. And I just decided that it wasn't worth it.
Mm.
And my last day in the business was September 15th. I drove up to Chicago to help set up for Ring of Honor and had some unpleasant words with some people there and decided, you know what, fuck it. I'm just going to buy a ticket and watch the show as a fan tonight. And that was it.
Hmm.
There you go.
So what was your record, wins, losses?
No wins, a bunch of losses. Not take that back. The first match was a win. Every match after that was a loss.
So you're a jobber.
Yeah.
Enhancement talent.
I was nothing. And really, had I known that our first match, which was against the Mobile Homers, had I known.
The Mobile Homers.
Yes.
They're from Kentucky. They were from Kentucky.
Now, obviously.
This is okay.
Now, all three of those guys. All three of those guys are really good. And had I known it was their first match as a unit and that they would go on to be like a good team in this area, I would have insisted on losing. But you know, I had no idea. I was just happy to have sold the most tickets. So I went up in the end.
Excellent.
But they fucking stone cold stunner because there's no way a rookie can fuck up a stunner.
Well, that's something else I wanted to ask about. Did you have like certain moves that were your favorite to do or that you knew that like you looked really cool doing? Did you get that far along to develop that sense?
No, I have the athletic ability of a sloth.
I see.
So yeah, I was not going to go far in that business as a wrestler. Everything about me is average. I'm 5'10", 200-ish pounds. I was a hell of a promo though, but in my position, I could not cut promos. The OVW TV was dominated by people, rightfully so. They were on WWE developmental deals.
Yeah.
So if I was on TV, it was to break up a fight or to set up an interview segment or something like that. Like I was not given a chance to shine. And keep in mind, at the time, Alicia Fox had just got hired with Kelly Kelly because Johnny Ace liked the way they looked in the swimsuit catalog.
Mm-hmm.
Like Barbie, Kelly Kelly was brought up to TV literally 3 weeks after getting signed because she looked good. Meanwhile, Nigel McGuinness, Roderick Strong, Brian Danielson, they could not get deals even though they were amazing wrestlers. So I just saw the writing on the wall and knew that I was never going to make it in that business and I would just be getting CTE for no reason.
Mm.
Well, I mean, yeah. Roderick Strong's doing pretty good at this point.
Yeah. Now.
Right.
It took, you know, by then I was making pretty good money in the healthcare field that I would be risking by getting dropped on my head by someone who doesn't know what they're doing. Mm-hmm. Whereas Roddy was working with trained professionals and already had a name established by that point.
There's a lot to risk and a lot to walk away from, in other words. So you have remained somewhat involved, at least interested, in the wrestling industry from a fan perspective. And Kelly, I understand that you have been sucked into this world as well.
I feel like I want to tell you this. When I met Steve, when we first started talking, he was like, I sort of like, he kind of was like, I kind of like wrestling. But he did not. Like, I don't feel
kinda like Chris.
Really. I can't remember exactly how he said it, but it was not. But he loves it, even though I think he has a love-hate thing with it sometimes. And I was like, oh, yeah. I mean, I know, like, the big wrestlers. And I went through periods of time in life where I'd kind of watch, like, some of the big shows at WWE. But I was like, I didn't know any. I mean, I don't know anything compared to anybody in this whole Place to Be Nation. I've got to know less than even Jeff. But... I mean, I've got to know less than him. So, but I've learned a lot more. I still don't feel like I, what did I call it, Steve? The people getting hit in the chest. I called, I don't even know the name. It's like,
yeah, I took her to her first live show a few weeks ago and she was identifying chops as chest slaps.
Chest slaps.
I mean,
well, that's, I mean, that's legit.
But he's like, oh, they're called chops, you know, but what are they called? Chops?
Yeah,
chops.
Okay, you did. I mean, that's exactly what I would call them if I, you know, hadn't been inundated by this for 25 years.
Right? Yeah. Yeah. I, my ex's grandmother actually always loved wrestling, so I would watch it with her and I'd rent like WrestleMania for her, like at my house, but I didn't really like, it was more like I'd have her over and make food and you know what I mean? So it was like, so she really loved it. And you know, she was like, well, she passed away I guess it's been a year and a half now or something, but she's like in her 80s, you know what I mean? But she always, but she like believed, you know what I mean? So it was almost like too much for me, but I would kind of, you know, I'd watch it with her a little bit, but I'd be making sure she had food or whatever, you know, it was just like whatever. Yeah. So,
make an event of it.
Yeah, make an event of it because it was something she really cared about, you know? So I didn't, I don't know enough, but Steve had me on his wrestling show. So, we talked about it, but I didn't, I had a really good time actually. We were maybe going to go to a WWE show, but, it wasn't, I guess, Steve, maybe people that he thought was worth going to see. Is that the right way to say that? You didn't want to see, I guess?
Yeah, it was killing off one bad week of television, and I did not want to pay and drive an hour to see another bad week of television.
So we're like, no, we're not going to go to that. But the event I will say, and this is probably just me, like I'm one of those people, I'd like to go see local musicians play and versus going to like a big concert. And I felt like that's how I felt when I went to that little, like the wrestling show. Like, I think I enjoyed that a lot. And I don't know that I would enjoy like WrestleMania as much as that. Cause I don't like that many people. Like, I don't want to be in that. How many people are at WrestleMania? That's too many.
You would like it, I promise.
I would probably have like super high anxiety. Be like, this is too many fucking people.
If you just like started with like the indie stuff and then went to like house shows and then to like a pay-per-view, I think you could probably build up because that was my experience with it. So, well, kind of, but
I was gonna say, didn't you start with WrestleMania?
But then I went to house shows, and then I like now I'm addicted to live wrestling, so it's like a thing.
Yeah, well, I had a good time. Like, I'll be honest, really was not expecting. Even some of my girlfriends here, I'm like, I'm going to wrestle. Steve's taking me to a wrestling show, and they're like, what the fuck?
Oh, I know.
Like,
yeah,
they didn't really. They're just kind of like, we know he's into that, you know. And I was like, but I really had a good time. Like, it was a cool event, but I don't know if they're all like that. It's the only one I went to, but I actually had a really good time. It was fun. So even though I grew up with brothers, some of that like nasty, like some of that I wasn't into. Like, I don't want to see blood. I don't want to see spit, that kind of shit. It's just not for me. I know, but I want to watch that in football or hockey. I want to see it in those, but I don't really want to see it anywhere else. It's very weird. I don't know. Strange. Yeah. But it was fun. I liked it.
I've never not had fun in a live wrestling event.
Ever. Yeah, Steve's been to a ton of them. Yeah,
it's always fun.
Yeah.
This was the first time I ever had the podcast shouted out on a live wrestling show, though. That was fucking weird.
Yes, one of the main guys, like one of the main wrestlers.
You guys are like VIPs at the show, huh?
Right? Yeah, Kelly doesn't quite understand that people do know me, like in this region anyway. So there were a couple times where somebody would just come out and shake my hand and then just disappear. She's like, what the fuck is going on here?
No, I
don't. Who are these people?
Don't touch me. No.
You know, then main events, one of the champion of the Bizarro Lucha was up on the ropes doing his, you know, heel shit. And I'm just kind of in my own little world bopping to Tupac's Hail Mary's playing. And I look over and Nick Iggy is standing on the ropes and staring at me, telling me to shut up. And then he just blurts out, this isn't even on Songs of Friends. You stop right now. Yeah. I'm like, what the fuck?
Yeah. Wow. That shocked us, honestly. I was like, oh. Yes, it was fun. And I'm probably repeating if anybody listened to the show, but there was a couple, even some of the entrances and stuff, I was like very impressed. I didn't expect maybe some of that, like, I don't want to say extravagance, but just, you know, like the music that they had or their gear. And some of it wasn't for me. I was like, oh, I'm not really into that character, but there was some really, like, there was some great, what's his name, Steve Mancer?
Mance Warner.
Mance Warner. He was awesome, I thought. And when he came out, like his whole thing, it was like, it was memorable to me. I'm like, oh, I always probably remember that. So, yeah.
Well, speaking of local artists, local performance artists, perhaps, Steve, can you explain, please, SCI?
Oh, my.
Oh, my God.
All which, right.
I've never been, but I'm going this year.
Yes, this is why I asked.
Does this all explanation right, need like a break before we start that?
And sorry, Jenny, you're supposed to come. Ben wants you to come.
Oh, Ben wants me to come, so I should probably do that.
Yeah, I think
also,
this actually
I punched him in the face last time I saw him. So
this would probably be a good topic to go to break from.
Yes.
SCI is the Scenic City Invitational based out of Chattanooga, Tennessee. It is a two-day independent wrestling tournament featuring, you know, just not the same kind of local schmoes you have at most shows. Like the first time I went, Joey Janela and Darby Allin wrestled each other. You know, those are guys that are certainly not, you know, native to that scene. They bring in some of the top guys from around the country. But what it has turned into, as promoted by Dylan Hales, is almost like a wrestling Twitter reunion. You end up with this all kinds of fucking people. The wrestlers and fans stay at the same hotel, the Best Western Heritage Inn in lovely Chattanooga.
Best Western?
Yes.
It has to be the same hotel, right?
Which has a 24-hour diner attached to it.
Come if Tony Schiavone's going to be there.
Is he gonna Conrad be there? Thompson. Conrad came last year.
So the chances are pretty high then.
Yeah, I actually introduced myself to Conrad and tried to get him on Songs of Friends.
Oh my God. No, you did not.
I did, in over fucking cheesecake. I just walk up on it. I'm like, hey, man, how's it going?
You can't interrupt a fat man during cheesecake. What are you thinking?
Hey, man, I'm trying
Steve
to eat some
does, fucking Steve
cheesecake.
Does not care.
Let me preface this with saying I am friends with Bruce Mitchell just through sheer happenstance. I befriended Bruce of the Torch. And Bruce had just walked up on him. So I said, fuck, if it's good enough for Bruce, it's good enough for me. You know, not minding that Bruce has been in the wrestling business for 30 fucking years, and I'm nobody.
No.
Say, hey, Conrad, how's it going? Big fan of your work. I'm doing this podcast. I'm in room, you know, 119. If you want to come join me for a song, that's great. If not, that's cool, too. Enjoy your cheesecake. Thanks for bringing Tony back into the forefront. He said, oh, thanks, man. I think he thinks I was possibly mentally retarded.
Was this drunk night? No.
It was the early part of drunk night.
Oh, okay.
And because he just had this wide-eyed look on his face, he said, well, thank you, sir. I appreciate that.
Oh, my God. He's like, little buddy.
He's bound to have had worse interactions.
Oh, for sure. That's true.
Yeah, and I never saw him again after that. So.
Oh, my gosh. That's
yeah,
awesome.
Anybody who is worried about coming to a wrestling show and not having a good time, I implore them to come to SCI. Because I last year likened it to the... that Blind Melon music video with a B-girl.
Oh, God. Right. Yes.
It's these fucking people that don't fit in anywhere else in the world, but, like, this is where the bees come. It's SCI. By all means, come. Have a fucking beer with us. Have some biscuits. We've been making this Maple Street Biscuit Company thing, breakfast a thing. It's a good time. I recommend everyone come to Chattanooga the first weekend in August. Floor seats are $15. General admission is $10.
Damn, okay. It, you've almost talked me into it.
I did look at the hotel pictures. It doesn't look like super shady, but we'll see. Steve, is it bad? Is the hotel nice?
Not at all. I would not implore anyone to come if it was a shitty hotel. Ben of Row 1, Seat 1 is like the unofficial mayor of Chattanooga that weekend. You'll see him out and about making airport trips, making sure everybody's comfortable, making sure everybody's where they need to be. Last year, he had us over for a delightful taco dinner. So yeah, it is really a community-wide event.
Yeah.
All right. Well, on that note, I think that's bringing us into a very hard break. Why don't we reset, get some refreshments, make some travel arrangements perhaps. Mm-hmm. And then we will come back with the second half of our episode featuring Stephen Kelly of the Songs with Friends podcast here on Talking Pop with Friends.
Steve, have you ever punched Ben in the face? Because it's real fun.
Promotional consideration paid for by the following.
Place to Be Nation's JT Rosero and Chad Campbell here. We want to let you know that we have over 24 podcasts available on iTunes, Stitcher, Google Play, and PlaceToBeNation.com. We now offer them to you on two great feeds. On the Place to Be Nation Wrestling feed, we dive into topics running the gamut from today's WWE to the glory days of yesteryear and the ins and outs of the territory days. In addition to our full-length shows, we also deliver to you special pod blasts on topics old and new.
The Place to Be Nation pop feed is a veritable treasure trove of great content. Offer tremendous shows covering the land of movies, television, life, comics, and sports, brought to you by the most knowledgeable and insightful folks in the podcast world.
You can find all these great shows, plus archives of our past podcasts from over the past 8 years as well by subscribing to both feeds on iTunes. And while you're there, be sure to rate and leave feedback as well. All of these shows, plus others, available on PlaceToBeNation.com, where we cover pro wrestling, sports, movies, comics, plus in-depth stretch projects, and much more. Be sure to support our site by using www.PlaceToBeNation.com/Amazon when doing your online shopping. We want to thank our friends at Boneheads, Wing Bar, ProWrestlingOnly.com, and TheHistoryOfWrestling.com as well. Be sure to follow us on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, and Tumblr. PlaceToBeNation.com, the only place to be in your pop culture world.
As we stroll along together, holding hands, walking all alone, so in love are we two that we don't know what to do, so in love, in a world of our own, so in love, as we walk by.
Place Be Nation. We are talking pop, and we are talking pop with friends tonight because I am Tim Capel with Jennifer Smith, and we have both the hosts of the Songs with Friends podcast. I have SoCo Steve and Orange Sickle Kelly here. I say that, but I did not ask you guys, Steve, which alcoholic beverage is sponsoring your podcast tonight?
I am sponsored tonight by the Louisville-based Against the Grain Brewery with the beer that is very, very creatively called A Beer.
Oh.
Yeah. All right.
Okay.
That's from the Kentucky, A Beer.
Beer's pretty weak for this show, but like that's fine.
I'm on number 7.
Decent.
Yeah, that's not weak. I will commend you there. Kelly, what is sponsoring your podcast?
I'm having Crown Royal, the apple with ginger ale.
Ah, nice. Okay. That's not bad.
I like it.
Yeah.
Whiskey for the win.
Whiskey yes, for the always. Win. Whiskey for the women, too, because, Jenny, you mentioned you had a little crown going on as well with Coke Zero and a lore tab on the side.
Right. Also a Fireball, but yeah.
Yep. Fireball, still going strong with the Bacardi Superior over here somehow. Bad choice. I'm going to regret later, but
you will 100%.
You know, that's
did
a
you
problem.
Have rum chata? Did you have any of that?
You know, I determined that I had some, but I did not open it.
Okay,
smart.
I hear that it. Correct me if I'm wrong. I've heard that it mixes really well with root beer.
I don't know about that. Probably. Probably.
I've only had it with Fireball. That's what I always mix it with when I have it.
Yeah. Doing shooters.
Yeah.
Very good. In any case, that is a problem for future Tim.
Fuck that guy. Fuck we don't give guy. A fuck about future Tim. Look,
he's got problems, yeah. Okay? I can't, you know, yeah. I can't be responsible
no.
for him.
Not the same but, guy.
Present Tim and present Jenny have to tell you about the moving and the shaking going on around Place to Be Nation. Wow, that was kind of a... Speaking of slant rhymes, I'm kind of surprised and impressed with good. Myself there.
Yeah.
Look at that. Not to toot my own horn, but toot toot.
Toot toot.
Jenny, why don't you tell the folks what's going on around the Place to Be Nation pop feed?
I will sure try. Of course, there has been a busy week on the pop feed with a little something for everyone. Ben Morris and Russell Sellers close out 1970 with a new Marvel Age Masterclass. Myself and the manager, Todd Weber, watch Yoga Hosiers on a freakout drive-in, which is fun, but not because of the movie.
And not because then, of the movie.
Yes. JT Rosero, Peter Winston, and Don Carrera pay tribute to the wonderful Veep as it winds down its run. They even got a shout-out from Julia Louis-Dreyfus for the PTBN Pop Special podcast, which was exciting and awesome. And I like to think she listened to the podcast.
Yeah. I think that's going to be the next show that I watch. I need a new show.
It's been hyped. It's done now. It's over with.
Yeah.
So you can just watch all of it.
Exactly.
I like it. And then listen to the podcast. And then Andy Atherton and Russell Sellers gave a look at Forgetting Sarah Marshall on an episode of Laugh In Theater, which I love that movie, and it's awesome. And you should definitely watch it and listen to that. And the Hard Traveling Fanboys head off the page with a review of Marvel Ultimate Alliance. And that is an episode where if you've ever wondered what it's like to hang out with those guys, that's exactly what it's like to hang out with those guys because they play this video game on the podcast. And, it's pretty authentic to who they are and what they do.
Yes.
And speaking of them, which I don't know that this is going to be relevant because probably by the time this comes out, the balloting has closed.
Yes.
But they're going to, at the end of the May, they're going to have a, they're going to wrap up their Hard Travelers for Hire series with a special giant sized edition. And they solicited ballots from the nation to rank the top, 1 through 22 MCU movies. And, so, I mean, like, you can still send your ballot, I guess, to nickd@placetobenation.com. With your full ranking of the MCU movies. And if Endgame is not number one, then you can go to hell.
Okay. your ballot may not be counted if you haven't sent it yet, yep. But you can still look forward to the show, which will be coming later this month, perhaps going into the following month. But anyway, there will be a giant-sized edition of the Hard Traveling Fanboys podcast where we talk. Take a comprehensive look at the MCU and unveil the winners of the 1 through 22 rankings that you decided. So that's going to be a lot of fun. We will both be on that show. We will be,
and that will be interesting.
A lots somewhat of debates. Unique experience. Mm-hmm. Yeah, maybe. Well, probably. Okay. So that brings us to the Place to Be Nation wrestling feed. So not the feed that you're hearing this show on, which I hope you are subscribed to, but our sister feed, Place to Be Nation Wrestling. We have had here lately, Scott, JT, and our former guest, John Arsenio Diamato, looking at a supersized edition of the Place to Be podcast. That is episode 519, where they talked about WrestleMania 5. I'm a little bit behind on that show, but looking forward to that one. Sounds like a lively crew there to talk that that pay-per-view.
It's real good. Yeah, listen yep. to it.
Okay, awesome. The aforementioned Ben Zani on the third episode of Row 1, Seat 1, doing pretty well if that's what your ticket says. He chats with up-and-comer O'Shea Edwards and then breaks down the Making Towns Classic and the WrestleMania Weekend Black Craft Wrestling Show. That sounds somewhat unique as well. Have not checked out that podcast yet, but sounds a little bit different and kind of had my appetite whetted here from what Steve has been telling us. Mm-hmm. But speaking of Making Towns, we have a new Making Towns with Friends where our very own Steve welcomes our very own Kelly to talk about her live wrestling experience, which you heard a little bit about in our first half. But these are two different feeds, so I think we can get away with some overlap. And you can hear a lot more about that on Making Towns with Friends on Place Beat Nation Wrestling. Also, continuing the dive into the vault with classic episodes of Where the Big Boys Play. And in the latest installment, it was Chad and Parv and Solomon finishing their look at Starrcade 1987. Now, of course, you have our social media pages and our message board at bigelow34.proboards.com. So for any information on joining the GWWE pay-per-view and TV match, greatest TV match ever project, get in on that conversation, start researching your list, hit up again bigelow34.proboards.com. And I think that's going to do it. So getting back to serious business here, we talked about the Scenic City Invitational. Mm-hmm. Now there's another component to this that we didn't touch on, but I would like to.
Let's touch on things, Tim.
Let's touch things here. Okay, and touch on things, excuse
let's
me.
Touch on things.
Oh.
And, you know, it may be, I don't know, this may be a rule we don't talk about, but SCI prom, what can we talk about?
I thought this was going to be something like crazy.
No, we'll get to that, I'm sure. What can we talk about when we talk about SCI prom?
Steve? Wow. SCI prom is partly my fault.
Okay.
There have been articles written about this, which do not mention me. Thanks, Bix, for the shout-out, you fucker. Mm. But myself and Brittany Fernandez, I believe is her last name, who is the live-in girlfriend of Jesse, who is pretty visible in that whole scene. She and I one night were going back and forth with just how our prom experiences pretty much sucked and how, you know, it would probably be pretty cool now that we're adults and confident and know who we are, like if we could redo that. And someone blurted out, hey, let's do SCI prom. And we kind of laughed about it and didn't think anything of it. And then when the itinerary came out a couple months later, fucking SCI prom was on there. Like, oh, shit, what have we done? Mm. So what this was, in the Heritage Room, which is like the conference room of this hotel.
The Best Western, keep in mind.
Yes. The Best Western fucking Heritage Room.
In Chattanooga, Tennessee.
Which we pretty much have free reign over that entire weekend.
Yeah.
There are other people in the hotel, God bless them. I feel for them making their decision to travel that weekend.
Because oh my God. Imagine just the business travelers, you know, passing through, unsuspecting. And this is what happens.
The fanny packs and what are those, what are those pants, Steve, that they wear?
Yeah, the Zubaz and Matt, Zubaz. Pants. Yeah. Matt Riddle just openly high as shit on the balcony. Mm. Yeah. Just all kinds
barefoot
of
barefoot and shit.
Yeah. That he was all weekend. It was amazing. Mm-hmm. But yeah, we got a DJ and it was a full-on fucking prom. Like, the So Bros guys that showed up, one of them wore, like, an evening gown, and they wore tuxes.
What did you wear, was, Steve?
I just wore a Nike tank top and cargo
all right,
shorts.
So, like, he went all out. Right.
I'm a white dude from Kentucky. It's what we
right.
do.
Yeah. I feel you.
But it was pretty tame until the DJ played Party in the USA from Miley Cyrus, and then the energy shifted, and it became full fucking anarchy. And I can't explain why that song did it.
Well, anarchy in a good way or
sexual energy.
Now by this point the liquor's kicking in, and I look up and I see people going nuts, and somebody is standing on a chair waving fluorescent nunchucks, and I'm having a hard time processing all this. Marco Stunt is in the corner chopping
picture.
Marco Stunt, who's all of 5'2" maybe, is in the corner chopping the shit out of people. We're yelling for the DJ to turn down music so we can hear him chopping flesh. Like, Dylan walks in and looks around and says, "Oh God," and just turned around and walked out. Nick Gage.
Some people can't handle it.
Nick Gage, who did time for a fucking armed robbery, walks in and says, "Fuck that shit right here."
Jesus, what were y'all doing?
It's Warner comes in and he's got a pillowcase. He's got a pillowcase full of beers. He's just passing them out to the needy.
Needy. Oh, God. Needy wrestling fans. Here's your alcohol.
Oh, yes.
Shit. Oh, shit.
And yeah, it got out of hand fast, and I'm still not entirely sure why.
So,
is this an event that's scheduled for the upcoming SCI?
We don't know yet. Dylan's father, Papa Hills, who was featured on episode 1 of Roll 1, Seat 1, he is like the, I guess the don of the weekend. Like, he decides if there's going to be extracurricular type activities. He fills out that schedule, distributes it, and it has not been handed out yet this year. Hmm. So we're thinking maybe we got disqualified from having another prom.
Honestly, that's what'll get me there. If you say that it's going to happen, then I probably might show up.
Yes.
Hmm.
I'm going to tweet. We need to tweet at them, Steve.
Hashtag SCI prom.
Now, I'm in Dylan's DMs right now, so I will pass it around.
But we need to get actual prom dresses.
I was going to say, you guys have, I mean, you guys are going to be like,
I cannot fit in my high school prom dress, but.
I will go to the mall and get a tux with a cummerbund and all that good shit. And we will listen to 98 Degrees on the way, just like we did my actual prom.
Oh, that's sexy. Yeah.
Oh, don't talk about Steve's actual prom.
No, why was your actual prom so
let's talk about your actual prom.
It sounds like it started off pretty great. You had some 98 Degrees going on. You got a cummerbund. You're looking hot. Mm-hmm.
It was 98 degrees in the back of the Ford Probe that I was traveling to prom in because the limo did not show up.
Oh, okay.
There were 8 of us gathered in my front yard for this limo. Us trailer park kids were real excited to be in a limousine for the first time. And they just no-showed on us. So instead we went in 2 cars, one of which was a Ford Probe. And, it sucked ass. As soon as we get there.
What was the other one?
I can't remember.
Oh, shit.
But as soon as we get there, my date. Oh, never mind. Let's back up a little bit. We went to like an Outback Steakhouse type place. I can't remember what it was called for our dinner. And my
was it Lone Star?
No. Okay. My date's
was
tit
it Texas Roadhouse?
My date's tit fell right out of her dress. And I didn't even notice this. She's next to me. And my buddy across the table actually raises his hand and says, "Waiter, there's a tit in my soup." So she's salty for obvious reasons. Okay. We get to prom, and you know how it is. And you have to ask your date in like January or February. Prom's not till April. Well, in the interim, she like got a whole ass boyfriend.
Oh. So
I'm signing us in, and I look up, and she's gone. I don't see her the rest of the night.
So she's still going to prom. She's still going to prom with you, even though she's now she has a boyfriend.
A whole ass
100% corn fed country fucking sister screwing boyfriend.
Steve's not mad about this at all.
Not bitter.
No.
So we met up for pictures later on because she agreed to pay for pictures. And, yeah, that was it. I didn't see her again the rest of the night except for the pictures. And I ended up leaving a little early and riding around in my buddy's Corvette with the foreign exchange student named Patricia.
Okay.
Where was she from?
From Germany.
Germany.
Ooh. Oh.
As my more explicit friend said, she doesn't taste very German.
Oh my god.
I cannot confirm or deny that.
Okay, that's going to be my next question.
So yeah,
doesn't
I was just
taste German.
I guess she didn't taste like bratwurst or whatever. I don't know.
I was about to say what tastes German.
I did not partake in the tasting of Patricia Kuklinski.
Gotcha.
Wow. First and last name.
And it had all the makings of a classic teen sex comedy, you know?
Yeah,
driving around with the
foreign exchange student. Yeah. Right? Yeah. Tits coming out in the suit.
Falling out. Yeah.
I end up at a White Castle with my buddy at 5 in the morning eating sliders, which is what we do in our tuxes.
Right.
And then I just went home and just laid on the bed fully dressed, kind of processing the night. And then my dad had got up for work. And my bedroom wall shared a wall with the bathroom. Mm. So I could hear him like sneaking around in there. Like, what the fuck's he doing? Well, it turns out he thought I had brought a girl home and he was trying to give me the privacy to close the deal. Meanwhile, I'm in there with headphones on being a fucking sad boy listening to Blink 182.
Yes!
Were you a virgin at this time?
Oh, God, no, but I was in the midst of the longest drought of my life.
Oh, wow. Mm.
The longest drought of your life. All right.
Bummer times.
Yes. So, yeah, that was my prom. It was something.
Kelly, what was yours like?
Mine was, I think, maybe more normal than Steve's. I went with a guy I, you know, dated for a long time, and we went with a big group of people. Where did we went and ate something like that too, like some kind of steakhouse. I can't remember what it was, but I told Steve this recently. Went to prom, whatever. I didn't do dances and stuff like that. Like, I maybe went to 3 my whole 4 years of high school. I just was like, well, it's prom, you got to go. But my school had rented out like a water park. So like at midnight or 11 or whatever, you from like that to like 4 a.m., you could go to this water park. And I thought that was awesome. So, yeah, it was actually probably one of the more like PG things I did in high school. You know what I mean? Like I didn't drink. I just, you know, went to the school functions and I had a good time. So kind of shocking.
Very good.
Yeah. Nothing like Steve's.
And now here you are, despite your different backgrounds.
What about you, Tim?
Oh.
My prom experience?
Yeah.
So I was actually going to go to prom, but the beard that I had at the time.
I was hoping you would say beard so hard.
Okay, so there you go. You're welcome.
Yep.
Like backed out because of some kind of drama with like her parents were going to be there as some kind of chaperones or checking in or something. And she just didn't want to deal with them because of stuff at home. So she was like, I'm not even going. So I was like, okay, well, I guess I'm not going either because what's the fucking point? But we also had, just an after prom type of thing, which was basically an option to keep kids from, doing drugs, drinking, and fucking indiscriminately at other places, right. I guess, at a school
concentrate all of that in one location.
Yeah, concentrate all that in one location. Mm-hmm. Try to control it as best you can, you know, and hope for the best. Right. And one of our mutual, somewhat more wild friends was totally on board, wanted to go to that. And I was like, okay, well, you know, I'll meet up with you there. I'm not going to prom, but... you know, that could still be fun. She got totally fucked up as shit at like this college party before. Like I don't know what she had done, and she was just like hit in the ass when she showed up there. I don't know how she got through the doors, to be honest with you. And so it was kind of an adventure that night, sort of ducking administration and other actual school officials, because like she's making a total ass of herself, but it's sort of funny at the same time, you know. So you know, we had fun with that. It made for a long night, but was well worth doing, I thought. I wish I myself had not been so sober, but, you know, that's the hand you're dealt back then. I think someone had to be, so it was for the best under the circumstances. But, I mean, yeah, I mean, that's the extent of my prom experience. What about you, Jenny? How was yours?
So, senior prom, so I'm a natural brunette, but I experimented with blonde hair for several years. And so I had my blonde hair bleached like I liked it. And then I had my tight black dress with my boobs up like I liked it. So I looked real good. Looked real good, Tim. Just saying.
That sounds really good. I'm kind of into it.
You know, 2001 Jenny with the super thin eyebrows and the bleach blonde hair and the perky boobs and the hot dress. So
you're feeling yourself. I'm right, feeling it.
It's just been downhill since then, really.
You just described Charlotte Flair's prom.
I'm saying we can compare me and Charlotte Flair in a sentence, and that would make sense. daddy issues and all. But anyway, yeah, so I was Queen Bee of my high school, and I was a pothead. And
you were Queen Bee, were you?
It was, yes.
I didn't know this. I thought you were more... Not. Don't take this derisively or anything, but I was thinking more kind of band geek girl who was fun to party with kind of thing.
See, like I am all those things. I am a band geek. I am a girl who is fun to party with, and I look good in a black dress with blonde hair. So
you are every woman. Look at you.
So I hosted the after party at a hotel room in which there were lots of booze and lots of drugs and... so that's
did Donna Martin make a fool of herself?
Yes, and we we fed her alcohol and she almost died. And then so we were at this hotel party, and a lot of people left because we lived fairly close to Panama City Beach. So a lot of people would go to the beach after prom, which we didn't, but a lot of people did. But we had a really nice, like, super fun, dancey prom, and you had to do the senior lead out and all that stuff. And, you know, your parents came and take pictures of you during the dance while you were all sweet. And then afterwards, they left you alone. You went and did horrible things and made bad decisions. So I have fond
was things. Was your date someone you were, like, regularly dating, or just some asshole who you thought would look good on your arm?
Well, my date is my current husband, so...
Oh, yeah. Okay.
so some asshole you thought would look good on your arm.
Yeah. Been together since then.
That black dress did it.
So I'm still on my bullshit. He knows.
Still, yeah, going strong on the bullshit. Yeah. I like it. Hmm. What a walk down memory lane.
I know, right? I was not expecting that tonight, but I'm glad it happened.
Me too. I am too. We all learned something, I think.
We did.
All right. Something else, though, that I want to learn. You guys, Steve and Kelly, are, I guess, technically in a long-distance relationship, right?
That would be correct.
Like, how far apart, just distance-wise, not philosophically, but geographically...
or both.
Steve Perry might say we're worlds apart.
Oh, yes, right. There but we not, go. There's another song. Writing it down.
But there we go. Yeah.
All right. According to the good folks at Apple Maps, we are 1,100 miles away.
Oh wow!
Is a damn near 16-hour drive uninterrupted.
Wow.
If you had the added benefit of a P base or something along those lines, you could make that in a flat 16 hours.
So, I mean, this comes with its challenges, right? I mean,
absolutely. Well, you know, we just saw each other very recently. We're recording this for those of you listening in the future. In the middle of May, we just saw each other the middle, late April. We have another outing tentatively planned for the end of June where I will meet Kelly's family for the first time.
Ooh, no pressure.
Yeah, the extended family, that should be a hoot.
Yes. No and pressure. Yeah,
from there, we're just kind of playing it by ear. I mean, I think eventually somebody's going to have to make a move.
So what does the in-between time look like when you're not seeing each other?
A lot of texting, you know, phone calls most nights.
A lot of cyber sex.
No cyber sex. This is a family show, Jennifer.
No, it's not.
This is a we did make an exception on the nightly phone call for the Bret Hart-Tom McGee match. That was a very important night for me.
Oh, Lord.
Yes, and I'm not calling you. I'm not dealing with that bullshit tonight. Just kidding. He was very excited about that. No, I was just kidding.
Yeah, that's another kind of sexual experience, I guess.
Well, that is a thing, because Steve is not a phone person, you know. I am. So my best friend and I, like, this is crazy, but we'll be out. She lives in another state. I met her in seventh grade. You know, we've been friends ever since. It's like, I could sit on the phone with her for 3 hours, like nothing, you know. She's just so, she's really the only person. And then Steve. So it's like, we're not on the phone 3 hours or anything every day, but, I feel like that's probably not something he loves to do, maybe, but he always picks up when I call. So I'll put it that way. But yeah, texting. And I actually think this is going to sound maybe kind of cheesy, but I think there's like a really neat component to meet someone when you're not face to face all the time, because you have to make it about something else, you know? Right. So there's a lot of things that I feel like I know about him, we know about each other, that I don't know that I would have known about him had I met him somewhere, or we met on Tinder and went on a date. It could have just been, oh, I met you today, this is it, bye. You know what I mean? It might not be. Mm-hmm. So I think that's, in my opinion, a neat thing about when you meet someone in that type of environment. But it does have challenges, of course. But, you know, like Steve said, someone's going to have to make a move.
You feel emboldened, I think, when it comes to text versus any other format, because you can just type whatever, you know, and you don't. I mean, sometimes you might second guess yourself, but like, I think it comes more from you, you know.
Yes.
When it comes from the text format, because you don't worry about, what do I look like? What do I sound like? Mm-hmm,
mm-hmm. Yeah.
And so it's just, it feels more pure in some way.
Yeah, and I could feel like I really would tell him anything and not feel like I couldn't. You know what I mean? So it's, and I can't, you know, not to talk about past things, but I mean, I was like in a situation like you, Jenny, where I met someone in high school. I mean, I was with them for 23 years. So it was like a I on and off, you know, but mostly on. And so it was different for me to like be single and then like meet someone, because that was not something, that world to me of like, the stuff people are like, I'm going online and I'm meeting people and I'm meeting them at the bar and we're going to, you know, that shit's like, I don't know. That shit's probably not for me. You know what I mean? I'd rather get to know someone a little bit. And I guess it's old school, whatever, but that would feel, I don't know that I'd be comfortable like going on Tinder. You know what I mean? I've never done it. But I think it would actually feel kind of like, I don't think that would be for me, you know? So.
And the thing about text also is in a way, you kind of have time to second guess yourself. It's, you know, when you're in the moment, either face to face or even on the phone, you might find yourself saying something and then immediately you're like, oh, I want to reel that back in.
Yeah.
For whatever reason, you're like, I wish I hadn't said that. And with text, it's sort of that moment before you hit send where you can look at it and go, could I, you know, finesse that a little bit?
Well, poor Steve, because I'm not that kind of texter. I'm like a, you know, those people that send like 15 text messages of random thoughts. Like, that's the kind of shit that he has to deal with. I'll be like, oh, wait, I probably should have sent that. But I tend to probably text the way I think, which is probably not a good thing. I think Steve's probably more mindful about that kind of stuff. So. Right, Steve? Maybe?
Well, part of that is me being in a, you know, my job, my background for the last 19 years now has been working in psychology. You know, I worked in psychiatric centers my whole adult life. So I've had a whole lot of training in communications and, you know, talking to people a certain way. So I do try to choose my words carefully, on and off the clock, obviously more on than off, but I'm sarcastic, and sometimes I think something's funny, and everyone else doesn't. Like, I could accidentally be a real dickhead sometimes. So I try.
That happens, yeah.
Yes, I try to be very mindful, especially if I'm communicating with something I care about, not to say something too just flippant. Because it happens. It still happens with me, even taking measures to try to not be that way. I'm a bit of a fuck-up when it comes to communication, so I work really hard on that, and I do find that texting does make that easier.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And, I mean, I don't know, in a way, with a long-distance relationship, it's just kind of adds a level of difficulty in a way that you don't have when it's just the local Tinder or whatever bullshit dating scene. So, I mean, there's something pretty romantic to the idea that if you can make this work, then you can kind of make anything work. Because of that steeper just difficulty level to it.
I think you have to be more direct because, like, you can't read body language. You can't read tone of voice. So it's like, you know, a lot of times when you read things, you read them in the voice that you think, and that's maybe not necessarily what they meant. So you have to be, like, seriously direct in your messages and, like, this is what I mean.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It takes away a level of bullshit, I think.
Yeah. Well, and I think now we know each other, but there are times I'm like, oh, fuck it. I'm just going to say it. I'm pissed about something. Not right. Pissed. I don't really think that. But, you know, but I don't – Steve is very different from me, and I think it's a good thing because I'm a very, like, emotional responder. I'm not, like, always thoughtful about – like, he's like, a patient person. Like, I'm, like – I'm usually late to get on a podcast, like, every time, and he never says shit. You know what I mean? Like, well, we'll start at 7:30, and I'm getting on at, like, 7:45. And, like, he never says anything, you know? Like, I'd rather be like, fuck, I've been sitting here in my mind. I've been sitting here for 15 minutes. So he's a much more – but that's, like, something I've learned from him. I'm like, I could be better about that. Like, I'm like, you know, there's things that are who I am, and I'm not going to change. But some of those things, like my emotional responding and things like that, I'm like, it gives people power that I didn't realize. You know what I mean? So that's like something I have tried to work on for myself. I'm not always good about it, but I'm trying to be better.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. The flip side of that for me is that I've been trained, like I said, since I was 18 to be desensitized to things. Just because I work with people who will just say things to get under your skin. You know, most people will hear just a vicious verbal attack and, you know, be ready to fight. Whereas I'm been taught my entire adult life to, they don't mean that. They're just trying to fuck with you.
Mm-hmm.
So the inverse of that is there are times when I don't show emotion when I should. It's almost like a permanent poker face sometimes that I need to work on. But something about the long distance relationship that I think works in our favor is that oftentimes when you're new in a relationship, you want to be around that person all the time. You can get burned out really easily. Like we can't do that.
Yeah.
It's physically impossible for us to be in the same place all the time, just getting on each other's last nerve. So at the very least, we can space this out just through sheer necessity of not being around each other.
Right.
We're going to stretch this bitch out as long as we can. Just we don't have to be in the same spot.
And then I feel like that makes your time together like even more magical at some point because you know it's very rare. So, it kind of heightens things when you know you can't see the person very easily.
Yeah, and this isn't a reflect. Okay, since I was with somebody so long, when I first, lived in my house alone and my daughter would leave, I would be like, this is fucking crazy. Like I've never lived alone, I've never.
Yeah.
And so I had to learn to like be comfortable being by myself and like establish, it sounds cheesy maybe, but that was something that now I do value that I'd never used to. So like I do value time where it's just me in my home. And that's something I would have never thought I would have said like 5 years ago, I'd be like, that's crazy, or even 3 years ago. So It is weird because that's like, I just enjoy that. And I don't know, Steve's kind of, he wasn't used to that either, I guess. So I don't know. Do you like it? I guess I never asked you that. How selfish I am.
Well, even in living in a trailer with six people, I had my own room and I was the only person in the place that had their own room.
Yeah.
So I always had my own space growing up. It was where I was most comfortable. And really, toward the end of my marriage, I kind of reverted back to that. I would be up for hours on end just doing nothing, just be by myself for a while. Mm-hmm. So, you know, it's not necessarily new for me. You know, it's always kind of been what I've been most comfortable with is being alone. Mm-hmm. But like in April when Kelly came up for a few days, you know, she was really mindful to say, oh, you know, I can be in the other room if you just need your space. Like, we're never around each other.
Take advantage of it.
Yeah, we're going to be in the same
room. Get out of that mood.
Because who knows when this is going to happen again. Like, I want to appreciate this time while we have it.
Right. Well, and, I'm not used to being around someone all the time, and he is. So I was like, I don't want you to, like, get the fuck out of my way. You know what I mean? I was like, but we were together the whole time. You know, it was fine. But
so I'm like, we're going to fucking hang out. We're going to watch Jersey Shore. Yes. We're going to enjoy it.
Right? There we go. Get on this couch. You're not doing anything else. No, I'm just kidding. But it was – but it is, and I think that's what Jenny said. Like, it is more valuable. But I think it's just the time that we – I don't know. I just think it's cool. I think what I have with him is really neat in that idea that we have to keep it alive in other ways that aren't just based on physical contact or whatever. And I think that's important. So, I don't know.
Okay. So we've got, we're meeting the parents coming up here soon. Kelly, you feel okay about that? Look, as far as how your family is?
I'm going to feel like a really bad asshole saying this, so don't take it wrong. But both of my parents are dead, so I'm sorry. That sounds so bad. But anyways, so it'll be
why does that make you sound like an asshole?
My parents are dead.
No, they are.
Thanks, Tim.
Wow. I feel like when I tell people that, they're like, oh, my God, I feel like shit. And I'm like, no, it's fine. Like, but both of my parents have passed, so which is, you know, whatever. I've gone to counseling about that or whatever. No,
it's,
just kidding.
It's whatever. It's whatever.
Well, yeah, condolences.
It is. But so it's a little bit different, I think, in this situation because Steve doesn't actually have to meet my parents. But
lucky bastard.
He's kind of probably lucky. Well, I liked my parents, but I don't think most people like their parents. He'll meet, like, I'm from Pittsburgh, actually, is where all my family lives, and so that's where he'll be going. And I have a very large family of people, and lots of aunts and uncles and cousins, and so that's where he's going to go. So I have three brothers, and only one of them lives there, so he'll be spared the other two for now.
For now, right. It's like not all the cards on the table at once here.
Yeah, it's a big family thing right now. Like, oh, Kelly's bringing a guy. So, yeah, it's a big
deal.
Maybe
they'll challenge you to a wrestling match.
Well, that is my time to shine and take my position as the alpha male of this family.
Mm-hmm. Oh, geez. I have, like, I think I have 25 cousins or something, and there's, like, 20 guys. And there's, like, 20 men. So it's not like we don't have a lot of women. So
just get in that stretch muffler.
I was about to say, bring that out of retirement.
Yes.
Which is in no way a sexual position.
No sexual connotation to that.
It's not at all.
Allegedly.
Yeah. No similarities intended or otherwise. Okay, so that and then what's next for you guys? The SCI? You know, is that gonna be your next
SCI, we're going to SCI, and we actually have a list of people who want to appear on Songs of Friends that will be there.
Oh, my.
So we will be taking the mobile studio on the road.
Oh, wow.
Okay.
And recording some content with the various members of Wrestling Twitter, perhaps a professional wrestler or two. We will see. And, from there, we'll just have to play it by ear and kind of make some decisions, see if this is a long-term thing worth investing in. And, we'll see. We'll see where the chips lay, I guess.
Or you could have a terrible, ugly breakup and, like, document it on Songs with Friends.
Okay, well.
It would be the equivalent of the 90210 where Dylan is fucking Kelly.
Yeah.
As Sophie B. Hawkins plays in the distance.
Yeah.
Yeah. Meanwhile, Brenda's in France trying to get finger banged by Superman. Like, it's all a fucking mess.
Yep.
Oh, gosh. Let's hope we don't get there. But we you never
talk about
know.
A long-distance situation. I mean, man.
Yeah.
You know,
as far as the show goes, we do have an endpoint in mind. We've already decided on the number of episodes. I haven't even told Todd this. But I don't want to be one of those shows that overstays our welcome and is just doing it because it's what we do every 2 weeks and nobody's listening anymore.
That doesn't stop most of us.
No, sure don't.
Well, we'll have other things in mind after.
Okay. Yes. Yeah. I do have a couple follow-up show ideas. I'm going to go ahead and put one of them out in the open now because there's no way I'm going to be able to pull this off.
Okay.
Please. I had the idea of a show called Background Check where a couple comes on and they interview the most recent exes.
No. He just came up with this today.
No. I'm like, that would be an amazing train wreck of a show.
Yeah, well,
we're
that'd
not
be an amazing
to do that.
Feat to pull off, you know? I don't know that many...
Okay, this would get on a podcast with each other.
Well, this is what came up. This is why this came up is we were joking around about like Steve's first girlfriend and then like my first boyfriend, like having them on our show. And my first boyfriend was like, yeah, I'll do it, you know? And Steve's first
girlfriend... So you got as far as asking.
Oh, I asked him. But okay. I really wouldn't want him to come on, but I just thought, you know, it's his birthday. I texted him, you know, happy birthday, and just kind of was like, hey, you know, Steve and I are doing a show, or we're doing our show, and we were talking about this, and he was like, I'll come on. But Steve's first girlfriend was like, I don't know about all that. She sings, but she wasn't really comfortable to maybe come on. So,
weird. Right?
Yeah, we've referenced her several times on the show.
Yeah.
So I thought, you know, it'd be fun just to kind of get all these crazy ass stories from her perspective.
Let her defend herself.
Does she listen to the show? Do you know?
No, she does not.
Okay.
Which and is that's a good thing. Probably for the best.
Okay. And yet still refuses to subject herself to this.
Maybe.
I like the idea, though. Don't get me wrong. I love the concept. I just logistically, I wonder if it's feasible.
Yeah. Right. Great. Like, who still talks to their first boyfriend, girlfriend,
yeah,
whatever, well, scenario?
Just like when you apply to a job, you got to show references, right? Like, you're in a new relationship. I want to know who the last three people you fucked are.
Oh, yeah. My God.
You're in a new, well, you're in a new relationship. Let's pull the receipts, right?
Exactly. I mean,
Well, and you know, some people don't want to know that stuff. Like, I do. I'm nosy as fuck. Right. So I want to know the first fucking girl you dated, first you fucked. I want to know what you did last week. Like, not like in a stock way. You know what I mean? But I want to know, like, Steve, to say a new girl's name, I'm like, ooh, I don't remember hearing her name.
What's the deal there?
Yeah, what happened there? What went on? You know, but like one of my friends, she's like, Kelly, that shit's crazy. I want to know nothing. You know, I just want to know you're here now and that's good enough. That's her mentality because she's like, I don't want to be questioned about how many people or what I've done. And I don't want to know about
that. Well, that's also valid. Yes.
So it's, you know, can see it both ways.
Okay. All right. I have a question. actually just looking for your opinion to weigh in on, has nothing to do with you guys, your personal lives. Jenny, I want your take as well. Hypothetical. I'm going to throw at you here. Let's say that you've been stalking a couple on social media. they had a mutual profile pic of themselves, you know, just being cute or whatever. And that changed to just like individual headshots within a week of one another. You know, nothing was announced. There was no like old photos taken down of each other together. They're still following each other. They still broke up though, right? I mean,
yeah, for sure.
Did they have an actual mutual account? Like did the Facebook say like Tom and Sarah Brown?
No, it wasn't one of those goofy shared accounts. It was just like the profile pic was the same and it's them. And you're like, oh, you know, they're a couple. And I mean, it says they're a couple, but at the same time, they aren't real showy, you know, in the first place. But it something has changed. And I'm like, that still means they broke up, though, right? Yeah. They're just doing that we're still friends thing, which is bullshit with everybody. We know that.
Yeah, I think they've split, but they haven't had the conversation with people around them yet.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
To know. And I think, like, this is maybe kind of weird, but I
hypothetically, purely, of course, right?
Well, no, I think they split in, but I'm saying, like, for me personally, when I went through what I went through, not one time would have I posted on Facebook one thing about that, like I'm getting a divorce or anything, just because I just, and if I felt like anybody that would know would be in my life, and you know what I'm saying? But people sure the hell notice things and would DM me and ask me, and it was kind of crazy. But I was like, I took certain pictures, you know, I took them down, whatever, and I got like people that actually messaged me that I hadn't talked to in forever. You know, they're just like, hey, what's going on? Like, I don't see any pictures, you know, on your Facebook. I'm like, holy fuck, people are nosy and they will ask you. So.
Were those people just like super thirsty and you think were like stalking you for however many years?
Yeah.
Some of them were men, yes. So I was about to say,
like, all of a sudden it's like, hey, what's up? Oh.
They're staying under the basket waiting for that rebound to come.
Exactly.
So he probably thinks it's way more people that, you know, would DM me than do. But it was, yeah, it was men. But there are women like that too. And if you're my girlfriend and we maybe even hadn't really seen each other in a while, but we were good friends at one time, I take it less odd. But like a guy, it's like, you know, like it's kind of weird.
I'm like you. I'm super nosy, but at the same time, I would never just like ask somebody that.
Sure. No.
You know, like I'll be nosy about the stuff that you put socially and like wonder about it and question it to other people, but I'm not going to ask you myself.
Well, especially if you're stalking. I mean,
Well, when you start seeing the quotes, like girls start putting all these quotes and shit, and they're like, the pictures of their husband's gone, and you're like, this shit's going down the drain. Like, you can just see it. Yeah.
Hopefully their activity is somewhat different from seeing statuses that
relationship memes and shit. You know, so I feel like you could see it coming, but I wouldn't directly ask somebody because I feel like if they wanted me to know, you know, we'd be friends and they'd tell me. Mm-hmm. So, but I would look at their Facebook.
Same. And their Insta. I mean, well, anyway. Okay. Jenny, have you any other questions for Steve and Kelly?
I mean, like, you know, I had floated the question about sex positions, but, you know, we covered one of them already. At one time we had done like a rapid fire type situation, with our guest, Tim.
I need to take a shot before we do this.
I'm going to say, how rapid fire am I feeling right now? How rapid fire are you feeling?
I always feel rapid fire, babe.
Okay.
I just peed in my cup, so I'm good to go.
Oh, there's a scoop, folks.
There you go.
Was it a cup or a vase?
It was a red Solo cup.
So just a trinkle, if you will.
All right.
And I'm not at all covered in piss at this time.
That's amazing.
It's you know, horrible. That's what it is.
Well, I might have had a story that resembled that comment earlier today. So.
You sure did.
Again, another hypothetical. I guess I'm just full of them tonight. Gosh. Okay, so we want to do a lightning round here.
Yeah, let's do a lightning round.
Do a lightning round. Gosh. All right. Why don't you start, Jimmy?
All right. Favorite movie?
Yeah.
Kelly, you say right. Favorite movie?
Favorite movie.
Yeah.
Fools Rush In.
Interesting.
Huh. Yeah. Goodfellas.
Favorite book?
No. Ooh. I'm not good at that. This is cheesy. I used to read all the Nicholas Sparks books, you know, and I fucking love every single one of them. Mm-hmm. So I don't know.
I've read those too.
Yeah, they're amazing to me.
I'm an autobiography guy. It'll either be Anthony Kiedis' Scar Tissue.
Oh, yeah.
Or believe it or not, DMX put out one in like 2003 that was pretty damn good. So I will say those two are pretty much tied for first. No, never mind. Scratch that. Motley Crue, The Dirt is an amazing
oh,
literature.
Oh, gosh. All right.
That everyone should read. Just for the story of Mick Mars thinking that he is, in fact, dead on a beach when he wakes up. He thinks he's a ghost. And he walks up to the beach house. It's when their buddy died in that car accident, and he thinks they're mourning Mick and not the friend.
Made it about himself. Look at that.
So his line of thinking is that he's a ghost, so he can walk through walls, and he walks right to the fucking glass door.
Oh, shit. Wow. Favorite sexual position?
Well, there it was.
I was trying to sneak it in.
You know, I was going to ask It'll him work. Like what their favorite current TV show was, and then we could maybe follow it up. It'd be a natural, follow-up question, but that's okay. We can.
You know, I'm like an old-school territorial wrestler. We'll just get out there and we'll call it in the ring.
That's fair.
Okay.
I like to be on top, so.
Nice! Okay, so thank you for a fucking honest answer to that.
It's an honest answer. Jeez. Jenny, you got to listen to the crowd. You know when to take it up and down. Go for the hot tag when the time is right.
So I'm hearing communication is key. You like to listen to your dance partner out there.
Just call me fucking Ricky Morton. I'm on the apron throwing sign language and everything else.
We'll never look at Ricky Morton the same way, and I'm so glad for it. Okay, well, I don't think we can top that.
No, let's go out.
That question. Jenny had another one. No, I'm just kidding.
No. Yeah, it gets way specific after that, so I probably should. I am nosy.
Well, I mean, can we even pretend that anyone is interested in any questions, more mundane questions after?
No, you cannot. Probably. You've done like TV show. Yeah, you did not. Oh, know. Maybe.
It turns into like kindergarten meet and greet. Yeah, my favorite food is spaghetti. I like green.
My dad looks at vaginas all day long.
We should make Jenny answer that question for us.
Jenny should answer that question. Jenny position. That'll be the
okay,
favorite.
What's
Jenny? Is that like the fucking Shakara special? What is that?
Yeah.
Something to admit it.
That feels very proprietary. Let's dumb it down for the folks at home.
That's reverse cowgirl with the legs under instead of on top.
Legs under. Okay. Mm-hmm. All right. I can.
He's like, okay.
I got the sketch pad out. I'm drawing a picture right now. Yeah. I
think I'm with you. All right. Very good.
Well,
there it is.
Yep. That's on the recording.
As the editor of our podcast,
yep,
we'll
I can, see what I can cut that out if I want to, but I probably won't.
You're the decider. All right.
Mm-hmm. I got nothing else.
No, I'm not going to dare ask anything else.
Tim, you could answer the question.
Okay, I wondered how long you would let that pregnant pause just linger there, and sure enough.
Trying to get the heat off me, babe.
No, it's, you know, I would say I'm a fan of the Beast with Two Backs. It, you know, pretty standard, but that's about where I go with it. You know, tried and true.
How does that work?
Well, just picture, you know what that is.
I mean, just humor me.
Well, there's a song, keeping it in the realm of songs with friends. You remember, I don't remember the artist, but the classic lyric, do it like they do on the Discovery Channel.
Yes.
Yeah.
Familiar with that.
So, I mean, yeah, get back to your primitive roots.
All right.
That song is on the draft board for a future episode.
I was going to say, yeah.
I sure hope so. Yeah. Well, doesn't leave a lot to the imagination, but fun song.
You know, sometimes you just can't miss X-Files, you know?
Oh. Well, what a way to finish.
Yep.
So strong here on
finish, for sure. Messy and awkward, just like I like it.
Yep. Yes.
Why don't we go into some plugs now?
Did we just do that?
Let's plug some holes.
Some pegs, some plugs.
Pegs, for sure.
Yeah.
Oh, geez.
Kelly, have you any social medias to promote?
You can follow me on Twitter. It's KelGene17.
Excellent.
The rest of my life's not that exciting, so that's that's it.
That's okay. Steve, I know that you're not on Twitter, so, you know.
Not at all.
Wherever we can find you, I guess.
Yeah, you can find me on Twitter at SongsWithSteve. We're for wrestling shit takes and just general nonsense that fills my brain throughout the day. You can follow our show Twitter at PTBN_songs. We drop songs with friends once every 2 weeks on the pop feed. Our latest show, the anniversary special, where we did an NSYNC video live watch.
Oh,
should be on the feed by the time this drops. We watch 8 music videos and track the rapscallion Justin Timberlake as he asserted his dominance over JC Chazé and took the mantle of boy band king. We do that once every 2 weeks. I recommend checking that on the pop feed. Go ahead and subscribe. I assume you've already done so if you're listening to this. And yeah, that's it. I don't do Instagram or Facebook or any of that bullshit. I'm Twitter exclusive.
Excellent. Yeah, I'd say as the boy bands go, JT is probably my favorite top. Yeah, so that's not a bad assessment by any means. Jenny, where can people find your social medias?
JT is also my favorite top, but you can find me at JennyCruz2814 on Twitter. And listen to the other shows on PlaySway Nation, pop and wrestling. We did a super fun episode of Talking WCW.
Mm-hmm.
We talked about the Steiner Brothers, so I feel like people probably need to listen to that.
I feel like they need to listen to that as well. And we're going to have another episode of Talking WCW coming up pretty soon, later this month. We have our topic now, and we will get to work watching some matches here. And I'm not going to reveal who our subject is yet. I'm gonna keep that one. Yeah, keep teasing us with that. On Twitter, you can find me at CYKE68, Psych68, on Twitter, where I just kind of retweet shit takes from comics Twitter and occasionally some wrestling stuff and probably about the extent of it and plug our friends' shows. Mm-hmm. So, yeah. That is my social media presence. I have no other podcasts really to promote other than to say, check out Talking WCW, our spinoff show, and here again. We will have another episode for you very soon. Anything else? Any other business before we get out of here? Any final thoughts for the world at large?
If Justin Timberlake is your favorite top, I'm going to go on record to saying Lance Bass is my favorite bottom.
Oh, yeah. Had to be said. Yeah. That's a mental pairing that's very easy to make.
Low-hanging fruit. I'm sorry already that I said it.
No apologies necessary. No. A lot of people's headcanon.
Yep.
Yeah, and, real quick. I did forget that I do actually have a wrestling show now on the PlayStation.
Oh, by all means. Oh,
I forgot about that, too.
Tell wrestling Twitter about it.
Yes, I do Making Towns with Friends, which is kind of a Steve potpourri of whatever topic comes to mind. We've already done 2 episodes. The first one was booking an all-time Money in the Bank winner going back to 1985. The second episode was Kelly's Adventures in Wrestling. So look for episode 3 dropping hopefully in the next few weeks. We will be talking 2002 WWF.
Oh, my. Quite a time. And no stopping, no limits to the With Friends brand. So.
Oh, we have lots of ideas. No,
I would like to see an expansion.
Much like the Talking brand.
Much like the Talking brand. I think there's a lot of directions this can go. And maybe. And I think the future is bright. Mm-hmm. So. Keep listening, and we will keep podcasting, and we will do it again next month. Take care, folks.